Good afternoon, I suppose it's time to get started. If someone is still waiting for us, please allow the people to come. If there is somebody on the slide. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the second day of the conference. My name is Bogdan Bialci, representing this university. And I have a pleasure to lead another panel, to my mind, very important one. Yesterday, some of you, including myself, were participating in the opening session, and we had a debate on globalization and geostrategy. And I suppose we will fulfill this vacuum today, because all our panel today is more or less about geostrategy. Actually, we will talk about new Chinese initiatives, so-called Yidaiyu in Chinese, translated differently into English once One Belt, One Road, recently rather Belt and Road Initiative. However, as my introductory remarks, what is important, and to my mind what is neglected in this country and probably in the region, are two factors. And this is already a task for our panelists, which I will introduce in a moment in proper terms. First, that we have two new Silk Roads announced in 2013 by the current Chinese leader, President Xi Jinping, and both of them, the landmark and maritime, are moving towards the west, looking from the Chinese perspective, and are moving towards Europe. So the final stop is somewhere in western part of Europe, in the case of landmark Silk Road, and maritime Silk Road should stop somewhere, maybe as it is currently in Greece, or maybe even in Venice in Italy. This is point number one. But like it or not, we, the Europeans, we in Central Europe, are in Chinese plans, imaginations, and strategy. Second point, we have a growing debate concerning this One Belt, One Road initiative. As you probably heard and know, we had already the first summit meeting this May in Beijing. Another will be in 2 years' time. And what is important as a message from the first summit meeting, that China is submitting, is delivering $1.2 trillion for these initiatives. Okay, I can say whatever. What does it mean? Well, I give you an example and a comparison. All of us should be familiar with another term, so-called Marshall Plan, which is an American plan of reconstruction of Europe after the destruction of the Second World War. And according to estimates by economists, the Marshall Plan in current US dollars was somewhere between 80 to 90 billion US dollars of current US dollars. What does it mean? The Chinese initiative is 12 or more times more than the Marshall Plan is from history. So we have a task to discuss during our panel. Now, I will not introduce myself with the exception of one. I'm an old China fan. I was for the first time in China in 1976. Last time in China half a year ago, and go to China in September. So commuting almost like our host yesterday, who is commuting between America and Poland. I'm commuting between Poland and China, and that's it. In our panel, we have the schedule for a week that we have, as you see, three speakers, every one of them will have some 30 to 25 minutes, no more than that. I will be strict with the rules. And afterwards, I hope for a question and answer and a debate. And who are our panelists? First of all, Professor Wang Yizhou, a distinguished scholar and renowned scholar in India. He spent many, many years in probably the most important Chinese think tank working for the Chinese authorities, which is the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences. And right now, I understand he went back to his alma mater, to Beijing University, the University of Beijing, which is, like it or not, more or less Beta, is like Warsaw University here in Poland. So Professor Wang Yizhou was spending many, many years and decades observing carefully our region, mostly Hungary, but also Central Europe, including Poland. And definitely his presentation will be extremely interesting. May I add one thing, that his previous work job, which is Institute of Europe of Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, has published recently the whole library of new volumes, both in English and Chinese, concerning Belt and Road, concerning also another initiative which I didn't mention, but of course it will reappear during our debate, which is another Chinese strategy towards us, 16+1. It was announced here in this city in April 2012 by the previous Chinese Prime Minister Li Jiabao, and the Chinese have another strategy towards us. So Professor Wang Yizhou will be the first. Second will be our co-sponsor, if I may say so, because this panel is supported not only by Warsaw University, but the University of Łódź. Bartosz Kowalski is specializing in China, which, by the way, like it or not, is emerging as an important factor on the Belt and Road Initiative. According to Chinese declarations and strategy, which should be a special hub. So ask him what's going on there, why Mr. Minister Macierewicz was submitting something which is keeping some headaches in their city, and we will see what the Chinese are doing in Łódź and nearby Kutno, because this is also part of the presentation. And finally, last but not least, another specialist of our region from Slovakia. I was convinced reading his name that he's Hungarian. Yes, he is Hungarian by origin, but he is not Hungarian fluent. We need to teach him. So we will send him to Budapest, to Mr. Orban's system, and he will be learning quickly how to speak fluent Hungarian, because how to be Central European, not be Hungarian. Why, by the way, we can say the same about the Poles. So more or less, that's what I wanted to say as introductory remarks. We have three distinguished scholars, and let's go following with Professor Wang Yijiu, and afterwards, after 25 minutes, another one and another one. Please, Professor Wang, if you wish, you can come here.
Thank you, Chairman. It's really my honor to receive this invitation to come to Warsaw here. My first time to come here 30 years ago, the whole 3 decades ago, when I was a junior professor of Chinese social science. I wrote a book about Hungary, Poland, Yugoslavia reform in the 1980s. And then I was invited by Hungarian master to Beijing. I then got a great chance to come here 100 days and then spend a lot, you know, very good memories. Now I see the world changed so beautifully, so much than 30 years ago. I suppose here, to be here to talk about Chinese new initiative, Belt and Road. I want to use a simple word, Silk Road Initiative. Instead of focusing the global trade aspect of this initiative, I rather want to expand this aspect to a more diplomatic political terms. I see China's policy in the Central East European countries expressing 3 stages. Earlier, first version or first iteration, we call the Mao Zedong's era. The second one is Deng Xiaoping's era. And now we are in the second stage, that third stage. The first one is in the studies era. China is a very left wing, very extreme left wing. So in that period, China supports the Stalin's Soviet regime to press the Poland and Hungarian protections in 1956. Maybe many of you don't know idea about that period. But that period, China is a revolutionary bloc member, trying to take side of Soviet Union. So no economic trade interest on this region, but see this place as a communist partner, and then when Hungary and Poland have some protections, democratic protection, and China support Khrushchev, use tank, press. So this is the first area of China's relation with this region. It's very tragic, we call. A second one, we call the Beijing Peace Year. After 1980s, China began reform and opening up. The major goal of that period for China is to attract investment, trade with the Western countries, and then we normalize relations with the United States. The Western countries come to China in the 1980s, very dramatically, and China's economy recovered very quickly. In traditional Stalin's ideological goals disappeared so quickly in the 1980s. And then we see in that period, China's relation with Poland, with Hungary, with Yugoslavia, with this region also changed very dramatically. Say, for instance, I remember in the 80s, solidarity of Poland and Mr. Walesa being pressed by General Jaruzelski. But in that period, Deng Xiaoping said, no, we don't want invasion of this region's internal affairs. We just, as an observer, keep the normal relation with this region. So we can say in a certain period, no strong economic trade relation with the region, but also quit from traditional ideological Stalinist ideology with this region. We keep as observer, we keep non-invasion policy, try to non-alliance relation with both United States and Soviet. And now we are experiencing the third speed. That's what our host mentioned today. Today's China, why we initiated Silk Belt Road Initiative. I think we must understand what China internally happened. In recent years, after China joined WTO, China's economic social construction very quick. The booming of the whole our economically very fast. If you say Deng Xiaoping's era, China's economy are recovering for very poor, very, very low level. And then after joining WTO, China's economy began to take off, become a new emerging power in the world. And now China's foreign currency is the largest number in the whole world. Now, for instance, the United States own Chinese money, more than 10, how's English, a lot of money, US earn Chinese money, you see? And we are now the second largest economy in the whole world. There are so many infrastructure teams in major areas, in Africa, in Asia area, in Latin America. China is number one trade partners. According to UN's number, now there is 193 member countries of the United Nations. More than two-thirds of them see China as a number one trade partner, as a number one invested countries. So what I want to say, the East and Central European countries are now the new turn for China's economic expansion. We're now not only with this region, we are now already the largest partner of African continent, already largest trade partner of all Asia major countries, already largest trade partner with Germany. Last year, Germany see China as a number one trade partner beyond the United States, beyond Japan. So accumulated capitals, investment abilities, foreign currencies, China needs to go further, go globally, including Central East European countries. That's why China's government, with this government, this region, initiated so-called 60 plus one. 60 countries, including WeChat Club, group countries, Baltic areas, Balkan countries like Yugoslavia, Bulgaria, Romania, so forth. China wants to use the opportunities to supply more financial debt, financial money, and then to get more, you know, trade with these regions, and expand China's domestic interest investment to this region. So I guess coming years, we will see more and more Chinese tourists, more and more Chinese infrastructure teams, more and more Chinese students, more and more think tanks come to this region, to Budapest, to Warsaw, to Sofia, to Prague, so forth. That's very important, how we build a new strategic partnership. Now within China, we are discussing how we build a strategic partnership with this region. You know, there must be very careful, because we know this region has special political sensitivity. In the east part, you border with Russia. In the west part, you border with America. But for China, we want to simultaneously build strategic partnership both with Russia and with Germany, with NATO. So this is very important topic, as I know, in CAS and Chinese think tanks, how we build a neutral balancing equilibrium between Russia and NATO. On this hand, you see Russia. Russia is very important boundary neighbor of China. We have 4,300 kilometers boundary. It's the longest border. In many years ago, when Chen Mao in the regime in the office, China, Soviet Union almost involving the war, industry clash. Both sides built a million army along this border. That's very dangerous. Make Chinese enemy in Poland or Czech or Ukraine got some military confrontation with Russia. That will make this region no possibility to build a long, far-reaching economic roadmap. So our policy to Russia is how to harmony with this country without any military threat. And then when they got to invite Gorbachev to Beijing, we try to make a new deal. And then now you can see China and Russia is a kind of good neighbor. In the boundary between China and Russia, no tanks, no army, no this kind of military build up. That's make our the military budget can cut heavily for economic investment, for social welfare, for people's daily life. This is very important for the Japanese policy to calm down the relation with Russia. So now we think it's very important how to think when we deal with these 60 countries, keep the flexible relationship with Russia. On the other hand, you see NATO, you see Germany. Now we good relation with Germany, as I mentioned, as a number one trade partner of Europe. We also have a good relation with Britain, with France, with Italy, with Nordic countries. All these countries also see China's Silk and Belt initiatives as very important. For instance, UK's leader and Merkel of Germany recent years come to China very often to talk how these major European leaders built a partner with China. So I want to say this is very, very important for coming years cooperation between China and the 16 Central Eastern European countries. If we got some trouble with Russia, if we got some trouble with NATO, these initiatives will not work. Another important thing is that the United States, we know that Mr. Trump have a very special personality. He's very uncertain. Recently, when our president meeting with Trump, we tried to make some deal. Mainly two things. One is our East Asia countries area, like North Korea, the TPRK, how to keep from North Korea become a nuclear country. Another one is trade deficit, because according to Mr. Trump, US trade deficits coming from China occupy the 65% of whole US deficit. So he wants to make a big deal with China to make more American spend, American trade investments, and billionaires come to China so that Chinese buy more American products. That's now we are trying to make some big deal, you can say coming months and days. This is very busy schedule. In October, Mr. Trump may visit Beijing, and we will see an announcement by President Xi Jinping and Trump how these two countries, largest and second largest economies, make some deal on opening up domestic markets to invest each other to build so-called economic strategic partnership. So we think this is very real. If Trump and Putin got some problem for us, how to think we build a good partner with this region. So recently in Hamburg of Germany, when G20 countries leaders meet together, I think Putin and Xi Jinping's personal meeting, especially about the Russian's so-called strategic circle, how to make China and Russia coordinate in this region. We don't want to damage Russian interests, but we don't, at the same time, we don't want to influence American and Germany and NATO's interests. So this region, I must say, economically, tradely, is rather easy for China. We can do a lot of things. You can dual of things. We beneficial each other. But the sensitivity is that about the political, about security issue. If, for instance, Ukraine battle continue, if US, Russia got some trouble in NATO's eastern expansion, for China, how we choose to have a Poland, Czech, Budapest, and the Baltic area, what's our position? This is not very certain. In my understanding, in China's think tank debate, what we should have choice? Shall we choose a side or keep a neutral? Immediately, how we have a dialogue with NATO, with Russia? This is very, very important. By the way, I want to say, for China, right now, only economic support, but not security and political ones. In the global arenas, we still newcomer. We prefer sometimes take the free rider, the bus. We don't want to make an initiative. You can see initiatives or the monetary initiatives, but no security, no political initiatives. How to solve this regional, as we group conflicts, Ukraine crisis, Syria refugees, or Crimea political position. China not take position. When Putin comes to Beijing, ask our Chinese leaders, say, please support us. We want to take Crimea. Support us in Security Council. You are in the G20 meeting, but we said no. This is too sensitive to express our position. We prefer, okay, both sides. You, NATO, you, United States, make a deal, and then we support you. If you want China to take side of this issue, you can say similar in Ukraine crisis, in Syria crisis, so forth, we say no. So that's, you must know what's the Chinese limitation, what Chinese interest. Right now, our major interest is economic, commercial, trade, rather than the political or security area, and as a leader. In the region, in Asia, in Pacific area, we want to play more competitive role. We want to make a big deal with the United States in versus South China Sea disputes, in proliferation issue, Korea Peninsula. Yes, we can do a lot of things. But in European area, in this top political security issue, China always keep the distance. We want to say, okay, we're neutral. We want to work both sides to make some consensus, and then we will support it. If you are in a war, if you are very sensitive, for instance, in Ukraine, for China, not very easy to attract China's investments. So this is very important for China. Our major task for the leaders is still very inward-looking. This year, in the end, China will have a new Communist Party. You will see many new faces appear in political bureaus, in ministry generals, in foreign affairs ministry, ambassadors, rankings. They are very young, many of them, all up 1970s. But for them, the idea about Central Eastern European countries is very ambiguous, not very so clear. Why the Central Asia countries so hate Russia? Why NATO eager to expand its boundary to Bosnia, to Yugoslavia, to Romania, to Poland? Whether both sides, NATO, Germany, UK, United States, can make some, you know, good arrangement. Not like this region become a political security sensitivity. That's our major concerns, I must say. I also must admit, for the leaders of Beijing, they have very tough domestic pressure. In China, the pollution is very heavy. You heard industrial smog is very, very heavy. We also have a very big problem of the regional gaps between the coastal area, advanced cities like Shanghai, Hong Kong, and Beijing, and the Pinan area, which mostly are S3 groups. The gaps even larger than Africa and America. Within China, we call the three worlds. The first world, the second world, and the third within the China. So for leaders, the major goals in coming years is how to decrease the domestic gaps. And last but not least, I think it's also very important to continue our political reform, especially curb the corruption, political corruption. You know that the Communist Party always got a very corrupted, especially when they got absolute power. It's always been some problem. Recent years, Xi Jinping tried very hard to curb the political corruption. So whether he has success to make this kind of political campaign into an institutional reform, make China's Communist Party more attractive, we don't know. Whether he can curb the domestic industrial smog, we have no idea. Whether he can decrease the gap between rich and poor area, we have no idea. But basically, this is number one premise in the past. And then, after we settle down, we will decrease the domestic pressure. We can have more, you know, rooms, more sources to expand the relation with US, with Japan, with Germany, as well as the 16th century Eastern European countries. I hope in the future we can have more and more personality exchanges with students, with junior researchers, with professors. That's very important. I must say, in China, people almost know nothing, in a sense, about these regions' political sensitivity, about the construction or kind of the contradiction between Russia and Germany. So, in the future, communication, exchange of ideas is so important as a precondition. I hope in the future we'll have more opportunity like that in our temples. Yeah, finish. In our temples to have a more communication. Thank you. I stop here. I have no idea what you are interested in China. So maybe in the later on, in the response, the commentator, the linkages, we can have more communication. Thank you. I stop here.
And you will be your host. If I may, I would add two remarks. First of all, please, if you are listening carefully, there were several countries were mentioned, including Germany, France, Great Britain, but even once the European Union was not mentioned. So this is, to my mind, significant and I suppose a fruitful discussion. Point number two, Professor Wang Yuzhou mentioned that China is preparing a big deal with Mr. Trump or America. I suppose we should dig in and discuss this issue as well, deeply. He mentioned East Asia Pacific region and South China Sea as a particular region. However, and this is the last my remark before I will give the floor to Bartosz Pawlowski. Professor Wang Yuzhou mentioned several times about Chinese interests. Here I would add another dimension for our debate. At the very beginning of his introduction, he mentioned tanks, Soviet tanks, directing towards actually Warsaw and Budapest at that time. It was 1956. We know from the archives, Chinese, Russian, Polish, and the others, that it was for the first time that Mao Zedong himself, the Chinese leader then, intervened not to allow the Soviets to come here and invade Warsaw, which was not the case of Hungary, because Prime Minister of insurrected Hungary at that time, Imre Nagy, declared independence and he went out of the Warsaw Treaty Organization. At that moment, Mao Zedong said, well, in this case, I cannot help, he is counter-revolutionary. However, it was the first time ever the Chinese leadership, of course, having their own interest in their minds, didn't allow the Soviet army to
in playing Warsaw. And two, this is for debate, or you, for question and answer. To my mind, to my reading, this Belt and Road Initiative and previous 16+1, this is the first time ever in the long, very long Chinese history that we have Chinese interest to come. That's what Professor Wang Yuzhu mentioned, that we will, could expect more and more Chinese to come to our region. So when expecting them, I will invite almost the Chinese, a representative of the town of Wuhan and Wuhan University, Dr. Vladimir Skovarsky, to present his speech, also 20-25 minutes.
Hello everyone. First of all, I have to amend Professor Bulacic's statement. We are not co-sponsors of this meeting, of the panel, as a poorer brother or sister, but also we are only providing know-how to the conference or to the panel.
Know-how is the most important.
Sure. But in regards to the topic of the panel, which is one by one roads, first of all, I have to say that I perceive over, despite this economic agenda, as a campaign of mass mobilization, which is based on a cultural construct of Chinese foreign policy. That is, to get a power over international discourse, which is by far dominated, of course, by Western discourse, and it was designed by the West somehow. This political mobilization should be perceived as a part of ongoing political campaign, a process of building Chinese soft power, both inside and outside China. I guess the over is somehow also related, the idea of over is somehow related to mobilize people inside inside China. When it comes to Chinese attitude towards the CD, from my perspective, this attitude is deeply rooted in both China's and CD historical experience, which is also firmly based in modern Chinese ideological debates, which in turn are somehow often downplayed by observers, the so-called China watchers, that tends to see contemporary Chinese politics only through the prism of pragmatism, that the Chinese are masters of learning by doing. I guess that there is something more deep ideas behind that. Given China's historical experience that is having been semi-colony in the past, subjected to 100 years of humiliation, China, to my mind, wishes to become kind of key advocate of global justice. And for this reason, China presents itself as a developing country still, despite having this second biggest economy in the world. And based on this historical experience and desire to avenge national humiliation, which is, I think, still very much present among the Chinese leadership, so-called Xuezhi. China since the late 1950s seeks to receive equal standing with within the international community. Because of this humiliation in the past, the whole machine, the whole political machine works to receive equal standing within the global affairs. And this notion of solidarity with the countries that were oppressed or subjugated by the Western powers can be traced back to the turn of the centuries and 19th and 20th century when Chinese intellectuals undertook numerous studies comparing Qing situation, I mean Qing Empire of China, in its latest, in the last decades, and the countries that were torn apart by imperial powers, likewise was the case of Poland, the partition of Poland. These things were studied very, very actively in in China at the time. Among these Chinese intellectuals, I think very notable thing is to, notable is to note Liang Qichao's writings, who basically divided work into two, basically claimed that there are only two races in the world, that is yellows and whites, that are able to construct civilizations. And this civilizational attitude was present in his ideas, that basically he claimed that only whites and yellows were able to produce culture that are strong enough to be able to transcend states, state boundaries, and have impact on some other political entities. And to go back to the 21st century, the Belt and Road concept, to my mind, also reveals this civilizational aspect of Chinese foreign policy and this perception of culture, at least in its Eurasian sphere or Eurasian dimension. During visit in Western Europe in 2014, Xi Jinping, it was in Brussels, named Europe as the second civilization. I think it was somehow echoing Liang Qichao's findings, and he classified China and Europe as civilizations, and by this he meant to be like a civilizational partner. Because he used the wording of Wen Ming Guo Huang, which can be roughly translated as civilizational partners. So he, Xi Jinping stated that both sides share a very long history, are the birthplace of great civilizations, and thus they are taking common ground for interaction. However, a slightly different approach can be found in Chinese policy narratives or pronouncements towards the Central and Eastern Europe, which is embodied in this idea of 16+1 format that was initiated here in Warsaw in 2012. This initiative was advertised by the Chinese policymakers as a platform for economic trade, cultural cooperation free of any political meaning. And what is more important, that the 16+1 is advertised as a complementary to one belt, one road strategy. And it also underlines the themes of the so-called bottom line, the five principles of peaceful coexistence. And therefore, I think that there are some signs that proves that the political dimension in this 16+1 strategy is also much in place. Although for Chinese policymakers, Sino-South relations are have been traditionally defined within the framework of mostly post-colonial developing countries of Southeast Asia, Central Asia, and Africa, and Latin America, of course, recently. The membership in the European part of 16+1 is based firmly on the former experience, the communist experience of the European 16. And the line of division, if you look at the map, is drawn clearly along the lines of the former Iron Curtain, except for East Germany. For this reason, I think it's important to note that during the 16+1 summit in Suzhou, I mean, prior to this summit, there was a meeting between Xi Jinping and head of state of the European 16 in Beijing, and she described the position of China towards the sea, stating that the 16+1 provides a new platform for South-South cooperation within the wider EU-China relations framework. That is, that 16+1 relations were equated for developing countries and were somehow coined as a sub-regional within relations between EU and China in general. Uh, Global South is, of course, not because of geography, but level of development of our region, which is not technologically advanced, lacks investment in infrastructure. And there are some common features, especially recently with China as Norad goes against domination of West, domination of liberal democracy, and dictate of Brussels in case of political establishments of Poland, Hungary, the Czech Republic. And I think in this sense, this critical attitude towards Western values comes somehow like becoming convergent with the attitudes we are observing in Central Eastern Europe. Of course, despite new worries in Europe about China becoming more of a competitor than a partner, it's visible that China rather prefers to seek to group countries along certain ideas. And it is, for me, it's also worth to note that institutional layout of the 16+1 initiative is basically analogous to the layout of Chinese format in Africa, the SCOCAC, the Forum of China in Africa. There are very strong similarities between African and East European formats. In the case of CE, in the foreground, I think one can see above all China's attempts to influence politically in exchange of economic investments. I think in many countries, especially in Czech Republic and Hungary, the growth of Chinese investments is due to the excellent political relations between the governments and these anti-liberal positions that they are representing now. And of course, all the Western countries are also kind of soft on China's human rights agenda, but I think that case of CE proves that China is also calculating political benefits in regard to this economic strategy of major investments. It's especially noticeable in the case of the Czech Republic, in the case of Ye Jianming, advisor to, he's the chairman of the very powerful conglomerate CFC. This man is an advisor whose ties to Chinese leadership is not in doubt. He's an advisor, economic advisor to President Zeman, which I found, this of course proves the political dimension of Chinese interest in the Czech Republic. In terms of some direct influence of the decisions of individual CE countries towards China, it's worth to notice Hungary and Greece support for no, it was Hungary, only Hungary support for market economy status China. Only Hungary, yes. But in case of Greece, recent month we saw another example of this kind of performance. Greece, for the first time in the European Union, blocked the issuing of the common statement of the EU and the United Nations regarding human rights in China. The same was the case last year when EU tried to issue a statement, a common statement on the South China Sea after the verdict of the tribunal, of the Hague Tribunal, regarding the island. And going further, in regard to Southern Europe, I think Serbia is also a very thought-provoking example of this shadow policy, because China somehow follows moves of other superpowers. Serbia is a state that is aspiring to the EU, is at the same time having excellent relations with Russia, and being rather, let's say, indifferent with about the United States. And last month I found that according to recent survey, almost 90% of the University of Belgrade students are against Serbia accession to NATO, and more than half of them are against accession to the EU structures. And this, I think, further overlaps with Chinese growing political and economic presence there, including military cooperation, which is also a fact. Therefore, I think we can somehow observe a competition between the EU, US, and China and spreading influence over this somehow weakened and disintegrating continent. Of course, apart from UK, which is now trying to compensate Brexit with the promise of investments from China and Hong Kong, which is very historical and ironic because China was a semi-colony, Great Britain, the United Kingdom, and Hong Kong was a colony in a good sense. And in case of China, both US, I mean, in case of the CE, both US and China declare support, are declaring support to the EU unity. However, at the same time, they're trying to divide EU using the resentments present in the CE region. And in the light of the shadow diplomacy that might be found in China's activity in Serbia, I think it's very interesting to observe a joint comment issued after the Riga summit last year, which put emphasis on enhancing connectivity, infrastructure projects, and energy cooperation in the area of the intermarium of the three seas. But there is an idea that only a few days ago, the president of the US openly supported. The question is how the proposed idea positions the CE region vis-a-vis both the EU, like, whether it's a competing or partnership notion. I have a feeling that it's rather an alternative than a complementary part. Because in 2012, when the 16 plus 1 was kicked off in Warsaw, both US and EU were trying to diminish the idea or even block it somehow. I think that provides some proof that this intermarium, the US advocating intermarium, China advocating intermarium, has something in common with dividing the European continent. And in regard to the issue, again, with this culture, Donald Trump in Warsaw has also highlighted the civilizational aspect of his foreign policy. He finds himself as a defender of Western civilization, of course, not based on his own rights and interpretation. And this is, from my perspective, constitutes a major problem in performing or analyzing foreign policy, because we often use the same words that to express different ideas. It was visible during the Belt and Road Summit in May, when Wang Yi was speaking of Obor as an international public good that was given to the world. I mean, Obor is an international public good, which is exactly the entirely at odds with the definition used in the international relations by the policymakers and throughout social sciences. But this term is against the terminology, but I think the major problem is with understanding what is the Western civilization. If this world has on their minds Angela Merkel or Macron, or what is understood as a Western civilization in Hungary, Poland, or Washington. I think I will stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and thank you for keeping your time. If I may, I would also add two additional remarks concerning this presentation. Between the lines, one term was mentioned,
100 years of humiliation. Pioneer watcher, the Chinese term. This is very crucial for to understand the Chinese behavior. We have the statistics and data conserved by Angus Madison. He already passed away. He was working for OECD. According to his estimates, which we share with the academic community around the globe, prior to so-called Opium Wars, which means 1820s after Napoleonian Wars, China alone was giving 1/3 of global GDP. So what is the Chinese aim and goal? To return to this position. Why? When People's Republic of China was proclaimed on October the 1st, 1949, China was giving just 3.5% of the global GDP, 10 times less. So it was the real price for this national humiliation. And now China is talking about a great renaissance, rejuvenation. And second, my remark, it was mentioned about the civilization factor. I don't know if you are familiar, and you should, with the name of Chang Weiwei. Don't mix it with Ai Weiwei, who is a very famous Chinese dissident. Chang Weiwei was personal translator to Deng Xiaoping. Later, he was studying in Geneva in the Academy of Diplomacy, and he is now a kind of media personality, an academic personality in China, very visible, and he published recently 3 volumes in Chinese explaining Wen Wu Guo Jia, that China is civilizational state, that China is challenging us as a civilization, not as a country. And in this respect, China is putting ahead of her, ahead of this country, 2 so-called centenary or centennial goals. One for 100 years of Chinese Communist Party, which is July the 1st, 2021, that middle class will be created, new model of development will be introduced in China. And the second centenary goals for 100 years of People's Republic of China, which is October the 1st, 2049. Maybe I will be not living anymore at that time, but they are already planning that China will be unified, big China. Of course, peaceful reunification with Taiwan is also included in this strategy. But this is the background and the framework we need to discuss contemporary China, One Belt and Road. And of course, these 2 centenary goals are much more important as domestic issues for the Chinese authorities than any kind of external involvement. Saying so, I will give the floor to Mr. Duchani, who will not using, I'm using, as you see, as an old China hand, only the power of my argument. He will use the PowerPoint to this presentation. Good luck for him.
So good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for all those who have invited me and helped me to come here. I really appreciate it. It's always great to be here in Warsaw, and I really mean it. And before I start, I have a few things I wanted to tell you. One thing, when I'm giving my talk at the university, all my students sit in the first rows because
that's what I will do.
Because they know that I always ask those who are the farthest from me to answer. So that will put my friend Professor Rhodes first to answer my questions. Of course, I'm not going to do that. Second thing, Professor Belarczyk advised me to use MIND, not necessarily PowerPoint, I'll try it in bold. So I hope you enjoy that. I will mention a few disclaimers before I start. Maybe some of the things which will sound a bit critical, but I don't think that China and Russia should be put in the same basket. I think that's not often the case in Poland. It's very often the case in the Czech Republic, where I live most of the time. I don't think that the Chinese goals towards Poland, Central Europe, or Europe in total are necessarily bad. So I think that for us it is good to develop relations with China, though I think often there are problems, and these come from misunderstanding what China wants. It is sometimes the case that people here think that China is interested in dividing us. I don't think so. So especially in this new Europe, part of the EU, politicians sometimes act in this way, like China wanted us to be against Brussels. So that's my understanding, that's not the case. And the second thing, I think that sometimes we exaggerate the role China can play in this region, either especially economically, sometimes also politically. Okay, and in my talk, what I'm going to do, I want to basically look at the Belt and Road, Belt and Road Initiative. To confuse a little bit, I'm going to use two abbreviations, OBOR and BRI, just to keep you awake. And I'm going to compare it with the 16 plus 1 platform, which is a little bit older. So I think actually looking at the 16 plus 1, we can learn something about OBOR. And many of the things which previous speakers mentioned will be also mentioned here. I'm really looking forward to comments both from you and from the audience, because I will try to present something of a simplistic theory of Chinese foreign policy with regard to these two initiatives. Okay, so why I say that we can compare the two? If we look at how these initiatives were born, first of all, 16 plus 1 is a little bit older. As was mentioned, it was formally started here in Warsaw. I'm sorry, over there, but it could be Warsaw, 2012.
Too much of Budapest.
Yeah, that's my Hungarian heritage. Although, if you come to Hungary, most Hungarians would say that 16 plus 1 was actually born in Budapest.
Everything is born.
Since I'm in between, I will say that it was born in those 2 years. The year after 2013, the 16 plus 1 moved from the initial Chinese offers into toward the institutionalization. So in 2013, in Bucharest for the first time, the final document was accepted by all involved parties, while before it was really a Chinese offer. Later on, in 2015, in Suzhou, it was announced that Belt and Road, that 16 plus 1 is part of the Belt and Road Initiative. Looking at the Belt and Road Initiative, it came into existence in 2013, when Chinese president, for the first time, we can say, floated the idea in Kazakhstan. It took some time for everyone to notice how big the thing was, both in China and internationally. And a few months ago, in 2017 in Beijing, there was the first major conference. And we can really say that this was the moment of institutionalization of the Belt and Road. What I mean by that, we were told that there will be these summits of Belt and Road. I think it's every 2 years. Similarly, as there are now summits of 16 plus 1, there should be a secretariat. There are certain financial tools. Really, all these things are similar in these two initiatives. So what are the goals of the two? let's first look at the 16 plus 1, which is for most of us closer. So when China came here 5-6 years ago and started making promises about new relations and so on, most of the people here really thought that China can be an economic alternative. So that's my main argument, and I think few people dispute that for most of those 16 countries, China is really about the economy. It's about finding a way from being too dependent or over-dependent, as some say, on the Western Europe, both in terms of trade and in terms of investment from the Western Europe, especially after the financial crisis. crisis, when our trade with the developed decreased and investment also decreased, we were looking for alternatives, and China seemed to offer one. So really, on the side of the CE, economy is the main issue. Looking at the whole world, I would say the same thing. For most countries in the whole world, China is really about economic opportunities. Okay, looking at the EU, EU was not very comfortable with the 16+1 from the very beginning. It actually saw it as a Chinese attempt to divide European countries, which would somehow affect the unity of the EU. Eventually, the EU said that as long as the 16+1 deals with pragmatic goals, which it wants to deliver, as long as it deals with the economy, it's okay. Now, looking at the Chinese side, it's not so easy to say that China is really only up to economy. As Professor mentioned, the sheer size of Belt and Road, the promises of the money which were on the table, were really huge. It's almost clear to most observers that there must be geopolitical consequences. Well, China and most Chinese commentators would say that there are no geopolitical goals of China, that Belt and Road 16+1 are about the economy. What I do normally in this situation, I say that there are two groups of scholars. One say that China has economic goals, which it wants to achieve by political means. By this I mean that, for example, 16+1, China wanted to improve political relations, so it increases trade and investment. There is a second group of scholars which say that China has political goals. But let's leave it open for discussion which they are. And it wants to use economic means to achieve these goals. So by increasing trade, increasing investment, for example, here, China wants to have more political leverage, we can say. So what are these goals of 16+1 and all four? And actually, we can see that they are pretty similar. Still increase trade, investment, infrastructure plays a very crucial role in both of these initiatives. China often talks about policy coordination in pretty much any area we can think of, from innovation, pretty much any area we can think of. China would like to coordinate policies, and people-to-people contacts are very prominent in both 16+1 and all work. So looking at the 16+1 and the results, and some of this was mentioned before, actually I was here in Warsaw in November, and at that time my presentation was mainly about what was achieved in 16+1, and I was arguing for something which I'm going to summarize here, without going in detail, since I don't have much time for that. So I claim that 16+1, after 5 years, came to the situation of hot politics and cold economics. So what I mean by that? When it comes to diplomatic relations, it seems to be consensus, and I'm not disputing it, that relations between Central Eastern Europe and China have never been better than they are currently. People-to-people relations, the same thing. We never had so many opportunities to travel between each other, interact. The university cooperation is at its best. Journalists travel both directions. Lots of cultural exchanges. For example, Chinese authors come to the Czech Republic for 1 month if public thought. Really, there are so many opportunities now for people-to-people relations to improve. So these things have been achieved. Well, when we look at the economy, trade has grown a little bit, but not European exports to China. Chinese exports to CE increased a little bit, but not too much. So actually, the initial goals which were presented, also here in Warsaw and in Budapest, have not been met. When it comes to Chinese investments in the CE, which many of us hope for, they have largely not happened so far. And those which happened are not greenfield investments, which was really what we would like to see, right? New quality companies hiring high-skilled labor and so on. Extremely little of this kind of FDI took place. I have a few tables, which I'm not going to go to details, which give you evidence from what I'm saying now. I will skip it now, so I can move to the final part of my presentation. Then if any of you would like to see more, I'll be more than happy to discuss that. So this was about the trade. We can see that we really don't see major increases in the last 5 years, or even better, actually the years before establishment of 16+1 have brought bigger increases in economic activity than the years after. So especially, for example, for main exporters to China, which is the B4 countries, last 3 years, with the exception of the 2016, have seen a decrease in our exports to China. This is, when it comes to investment, very difficult to know the exact number. I will only show you one. And this is from Americs, which uses its own methodology. I believe we can consider it probably the most accurate one. When we look at the CE countries, unfortunately only EU members are here, and the EU members, we can see only minor increases in Chinese investment. Poland, Czech Republic, Romania had some increases, but actually Western European countries have seen much bigger increases. They are far, far above our numbers. So it would be very difficult to say that we can be, for example, rich for China to Europe if China is numerously times more present in the Western Europe than here. One interesting thing is that unproportionately, a lot of Chinese investment in the 16 CE countries focus on the least developed ones, especially in the Balkans, which are the smallest economically and also when it comes to population. And this kind of builds on what some of the previous speakers said, that China, in a way, treats 16 CE countries as developing world, and it utilizes similar approaches as it uses in Africa. And that's what I argue. This is why it can successfully do that in Bosnia, Albania, not so much in Poland or Hungary. Okay, there are a few explanations why that is the case. I think some of these are totally misplaced, such as that CE is not an interesting and stable investment environment. We could sometimes hear some people saying this. I don't think that is much true, because China invests huge amounts of money in countries such as Pakistan and Sudan, which are definitely worse investment environment and far less stable than CE countries are. When it comes to other of these explanations, I think they have some truth. I'm not going to go through all of this again due to the time limit, but I'll say that I think that the situation of hot politics, cold economics, is one of the evidence that Chinese goals are really primary political. And I will now move to this kind of the discussion of Chinese foreign policy goals and why they are more political. So there was some of the Chinese scholars mentioned, and Professor Wang also discussed a little bit about that. Since Xi Jinping is in power in China, Chinese foreign policy might be moving from economic goals to political goals. Obviously, this is not the consensus. It's not totally accepted. But if that was the case, the CE might be a good example of this kind of shift. Now, I think also both of the other speakers spoke about the interlinkage between Chinese foreign policy goals, national interest, and domestic politics. And this is really where I think is the key of understanding both 16+1 and onward. And I will show you now. I hope you can see well. Okay. So this is a framework which I built on. Again, it's my simple understanding of Chinese foreign policy. It builds on the three core interests as they were announced by Dai Bingguo, former state counselor of China. He said that Chinese three core interests are regime security, and then basically economic development, and something which then can transfer to non-material satisfaction of the people. So my interpretation of this is that these three core interests are not at the same level. Regime security should really be seen as the main one, and Chinese Communist Party, which is in power, really depends mostly on the domestic stability. Now, domestic stability in China is mainly achieved thanks to two things. One is material satisfaction of people. If you look at any table of Chinese GDP growth in the last 30 years, you will understand why so many Chinese people are satisfied with how things are presently. Secondly, economies does not need to be enough. So then there needs to be some kind of non-material satisfaction. And since early 90s, when communism really decreased, or basically is non-existent as a main legitimacy force for the Communist Party, ironically, it's nationalism, which is the main factor for Chinese government to keep people non-materially satisfied with its rule. So what I do over here is that when you look at the material satisfaction or the economic development of China, it really transfers to stable international environment. And stable international environment requires benign action of China. So in this table, I was looking at the South China Sea, which is a topic I did my PhD thesis on. So in South China Sea, for example, China would need to act in a way so it's not perceived as an enemy for the countries. Because if it is perceived as an enemy, it affects the stable international environment. The other countries might join hands against China, and it would affect this open international market, which is so necessary for China. On the other hand, to keep increasingly nationalistic population in China satisfied, Chinese government needs to show that it's very strong in defending Chinese interests. So probably you can understand that in the very same situation, such as in South China Sea, this kind of core interest requires Chinese government to act in a very strong hand. Now, this is a major problem for Chinese government. How to balance between these two countering goals. So what I argue, and I'm coming back now to 16+1 and Belt and Road, what I argue, this is really a great tool for Chinese government, how to balance between the two. For international countries, Belt and Road and 16+1 brings promise of cooperating China, of economic opportunities, and so on. For domestic population, Belt and Road and 16+1 show China as a leader of the world, provider of the public goods, as basically a superpower in making. So I think this is at least this is how I understand these two initiatives. And I will conclude with this one to remind the main points. So I think 16+1 and Belt and Road are the examples of politics by economic means. By politics, I mean that China simply wants stable working relations with the 16 countries over here. Economically speaking, they are not so crucial for China. Politically speaking, they are important both in the UN, both in the EU. Interestingly, China has achieved their goals in 16 countries, as I showed you, not by economic means, but simply by the promise of economic means, which is very interesting. Many of us think that China is so much present here, but actually data do not necessarily support it so far. Chinese domestic politics is the key when we want to understand foreign policy. And 16+1 and O4 both basically serve the same or similar purpose of giving Chinese leaders space. When international leaders are coming to China, and basically Chinese people are observing how their leaders are respected around the world. What's the potential problem? And that's the final thing I will say. When really it becomes obvious that there is lack of values, such as, for example, it seems to be becoming obvious in terms of the Central and Eastern Europe. Thank you very much for your attention. Looking forward to talking.
Thank you very much. Please be seated, yes, to the panelists. Before I start the debate, I would traditionally, almost by definition, give another two remarks. One is about, to my mind, a missing link. We have three presentations, and nobody mentioned, and this is a missing link to my mind, that One Belt and Road and 16+1 as financial supplement, financial framework, which means that China, together with BRICS countries,
already in 2014 initiated development bank headquartered in Shanghai of BRICS, and what more, next year, 2015, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank was initiated. Asian, what I'm called by name, but Chinese by portfolio and support, and this is an institutionalization of financial support of these ideas. And to some people, we have a debate if this is the beginning of the direct change towards that sort of Bretton Woods system, which is American dominated. So this is something about the missing link. And about the last presentation, we presented a lot of data on Chinese FDI in our region. I was studying that recently, very carefully, including our domestic here languages and local newspapers. And I published a study in Brussels recently on this issue. And it is surprising, all the data available is misleading. I will give you one example, but very significant to my mind. As especially the Polish audience here remember, we had the visit of President Xi Jinping here in Warsaw in June last year. And as usually, we signed some 40 agreements. All of them, almost all of them, not fulfilled. Formally. We also raised our relationship to comprehensive strategic relationship, the top possible level. However, what is hidden? Our intergovernmental agreements are not fulfilled, but the Chinese are very pragmatic. They came to their self-governments, to Łódź, to Kutno, to Opole, to Szczecin, to Lublin, and signed many agreements. And there is already Chinese investment, Chinese money, mergers and fusions, and this is undiscovered by official statistics. Even McKinsey and Rodium, which is giving the best available statistics, not only heritage, which you were using in your study. So, as someone who is traveling to China twice, sometimes three times a year, I know from my personal experience, if I'm flying to China or back from China, 90% of the people on the plane are Chinese. And this is also significant. So, if this is hot politics, cold economics, I don't know. This is for debate. Ladies and gentlemen, we have half an hour, maybe a little bit more if then we will have a hot debate. Now I'm open for a question and answer session. Please introduce yourself. You have two mics. Our speakers have their mics as well, so we can be interactive. Please introduce yourself, and I will stay here to be a captain on this ship, if I may. Please.
Hello. My name is Serge Maïsien. I'm the organizer of the summit. I'd like to thank you again for coming here, for speaking, for giving us some fuel for thought, and to think about China, because in our center for student studies, we rarely go outside Russia and post-Soviet states. So I'm very happy that after all these years, some panel about China finally happened, and we can talk about China and all the implications that, come from China to Central and Eastern Europe. So I have two questions, and one of them is especially to Professor Wong. It is, I'd like to know how does the Belt and Road Initiative work on the internal level of Chinese politics? Because I've heard it said not once that the initiative itself is used within the Chinese Communist Party as some kind of weight that is turned around, that is moved from one friction to another, to one fraction within the Communist Party to another, just to gain some political leverage within the party. I'd just like to comment on that. If it happens, if it does happen, or is there actually, are there any fractions within the party itself?
China is expecting 19th Party Congress in November this year. You will not say anything about certain administration because it is speculated and he will be in difficult position. However, there is something inside.
And another one, another question is I'd like to know, because as we know, there was talk about 2 billion yuan coming to the situation, not the situation itself, but to the initiative. Like, it was allegedly assigned for the long initiative, and no, but as Richard said, no really real and tangible facts were made. So I'd like to know if there are any plans, like, for really tangible projects, things that money can be spent on, that we can talk about.
Put it shortly, you want to know where the money goes.
I want to say
you will go there.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Who next is here? You have been invited. Okay, she will bring it to you.
Thank you very much. I'm John Fagan from Austin Martin. I have two questions. One, the first one. If you don't have any political and security agenda on your foreign policy, how Chinese government are going to protect its investments on one project? Because this project passes over the regions that are unstable, ethnic conflicts, also other conflicts. So how are you going to protect your investments in this region? My second question to Richard Turkanski, do you have any research comparing the European Union foreign trade relations between China and United States of America? Do you have any research paper on this?
Thank you very much. Next lady here. Yes. I hope not to Professor Wang, we think he will be overwhelmed, maybe.
Yes,
yes.
Okay.
Next
Professor
round,
Wang,
you will be excluded. Please.
Well, thank you very much for giving me the possibility to ask a question. And dear Professor, I'd like to thank you very much for your tremendous presentation. But I have a question concerning the Chinese participation in Shanghai Organization for Cooperation. What is your opinion? And how effective and resultative it is for Chinese development? And could we observe some internal, maybe, rivalry for leadership in the organization? What is the potential in China, or maybe Russia, or maybe India? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So we have the first round. So one, many questions to you, and Richard, one to you. Professor Wang, are you ready to answer?
Please do.
Okay, I do a quick response. First of all, whether the Communist Party will continue this policy of civic development initiative, I think it will. As I know that Xi Jinping see this international growth as more, I guess, easier growth than domestic ones. Domestic political reform, domestic gaps decrease, domestic industrial small are much more tougher than international achievements. So recent years we see the figures, international investment by China, the number much larger than what we attracted international capital in China after Xi Jinping got in power. So this is
we continue on here. There are so many reasons, but this is very obvious. We will not change China. I answered this first one. Second, but I also want to point out there are some obstacles in many Chinese views. When we're talking about relation between China and Eastern Central European countries. First, that is many media as well as some figures here figure out China say, okay, you are domestic human rights issue, that's good. You are market statutes are not satisfied the standard EU. Your state-owned firms, companies got too much government subsidy. All this criticize makes Chinese commercial circles as well as some policymakers feel uncomfortable. Compared with African continents, they are much less criticized when we got some economic trade investment agreement. So this is, I guess, when our colleagues from Hungary said, there are some people goals, if I say, yes, this is a kind of political goals, we hope in the future the political misunderstandings will less and less for the better understanding each other. You know, when you go to China, you know why the government gives some subsidies to these state-owned factories. You know why the government tried to do a lot, but still a lot of gaps due to so large territory. You know, in the coast area and Hainan area, if you want to decrease the gaps, not so easy. You see, the whole Europe, including Central Europe, Western Europe, Nordic area, is only 2/5 of China's population. So not so easy. Like, you know, I was, when I was young, I strongly criticized the Communist Party, Communist leaders, it is. But now I feel some sympathy. They have to be step by step. So the political understanding is very important. To know where China is studies, it's not studies model. It's not North Korea's regime. But we have our own capabilities. We want to do our own things by our own ways. But sometimes some Central European countries criticize China even much harder than Trump, than Merkel. We don't understand why. So this is another, may I say, political goals and obstacles. Last but not least, about SAO, Shanghai Cooperation Organization. I think China's goals to build SAO with Russia are very different from what we call 6+. Here in Central European countries, I think Beijing we want to make some economic trade deal, use money more efficiently, enhance both sides' beneficiaries. But in Central Kazakhstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, we feel some danger, we feel some threat because of the local settlers, terrorism. So SCO basically is not economic trade. That's a tool, that's a platform. But the major goal for China and Russia is try to curb the local, including China, Western terrorism settlers. So they are very diverse. Two pictures, very different. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you for the questions. If I may, I will also explain a bit about the data, because thank you for bringing it up. As you mentioned, we really have extremely limited knowledge about foreign direct investment. I tried to also say that, but I went too quickly through my sources, so I actually used data from Rodin, which is together with Merix. I used data from Heritage. I used Chinese MOFCOM data, and I use the UN data. This is pretty much the best thing we have. Plus, I'm also trying to collect anecdotal information, such as those which you say from Poland and regional governments. So this is extremely important. On the other hand, I really think that we don't have any evidence of any significant increase of Chinese investment. As Professor, you mentioned, in the Czech Republic, Xi Jinping visited a year ago, deals for like 10 billion US euros were signed, with 3 billion supposedly, which were supposed to come by the end of the year. Almost nothing of that materialized. And now, when now the best investment with which we can point at is where is production facility of screens where 200 people are working on. This is really not something which would save Czech economy. So that about the data. And one more thing about this, there was a conference in Budapest a month ago, seven people dealing with China city relations, and I asked, can you name me one major achievement of 16 plus one? And there was no economic achievement. Everyone said people-to-people relations, stabilized diplomatic relations. Okay, so that about data, but still that doesn't say anything about that. It can come in the future. I wanted to comment on the question where Chinese money goes. That was interesting because here in Warsaw, Chinese Premier Wen announced that 10 billion US dollars will be spent. Right now, or about 2 years ago, it was announced this money has been spent. But I really don't know where they went. And from what we see from the data, they probably went to government loans in Balkans for the highways. And this is really not an investment, because the way how it works is that Albanian government gets Chinese money, builds a highway, but this money it has to return. So this is, economically speaking, not investment. And finally, the direct question whether I did research on, was it EU or CE?
EU.
EU. I didn't do research on EU. I look at the CE mainly. In CE, American role when it comes to trade is not so important. Actually, Chinese role is quite important, but due to imports, because there is massive demand. In Poland, I think it's 10 times, 1 to 10 times. Okay, really big, maybe even increasing. So, but when it comes to investment, there is much more American investment than Chinese. I doubt that there is one CE country which has more than 1% of investment stock. Maybe some of the Balkan countries now. But for the B4 countries, Chinese investment stock remain far below 1%.
Just some very quick supplements. You see, there are at least two or several China. When they try to figure out how Chinese spend money, how to spend so-called investments or capitals, one China is so-called federal, central government China, by premier, by party chief, by some ministries. And then they commit something, they sign agreement with this government in central European countries. But many of these agreements would be very long, be a long term, which comes a very quick actual infection. But another one, or many in China we call the local China, or non-government NGO or commercial non-state factors. For instance, recently I said in China there is an important meeting in Suzhou and Shanghai about 16 plus one, majorly not about federal government, central China, federal China, but about the southwest China, Sichuan, Chengdu, Chongqing, basically the provinces and local cities in West China. Because I know why, recently I went to there to give some lectures. They gave me so many different images, information sources, which is different from the capital, Beijing. So that's the problem. You got no data from the federal government, but you go to the reality, or the non-federal level, you got another sources, images, tourists, or some kind of trades, or kind of a private deals. So how to make this data together? We have no idea. So that could be some misleading calculation.
I absolutely agree. This is also my discovery during my study. But if I may add one significant point, concerning the APIs. Within this framework of 16 plus 1, so-called flagship investment should be Budapest Belgrade Bullet Train, which was signed during the third summit meeting of 16 plus 1. It is not allowed until today because, according to the European Commission statement and documents even published early this year, this is non-transparent. So we have many obstacles, bureaucratic, institutional, and mental. I mentioned in one of my interventions that this Chinese Academy of Social Sciences has published a series of books concerning our bilateral relationship, Central Europe, or Central and East Europe with China. And probably the most important one is by Liu Zhuohui in London. Liu Zhuohui published a book, a short volume in English, and it says that mental obstacles are the most problematic. This is that we have different business mentalities. And this is something which is a real obstacle and barrier when we are talking where the money goes. Second round, another three or four questions. Who is ready? Later here, later on in the meeting. China needs to be represented as well during that session. Please. Louder.
And the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, but here I'm more like a scholar. I wanted to talk a little bit about data, which when I discovered this data, I was really amazed at it. So, in 2013, if we take the foreign measure, one transport, railway transport, were 17 million in China in 2013 exported 84 such exports. Yes, some more. Then 1 year later, it exported, it sent out 304 such transports. Later, all 1 year later, it was 800 then transports. Then 1 year later, it was 1,000. And 500, so it was this year, 2016. And by year 2020, China is going to send out 5,000 subjects. So if you multiply 5,000 by 17, you will get 85 and 90. So to me, this is the real measure of the Chinese ideas concerning Europe and global trade. This is what Mr. Putin also said during May summit in Beijing, that New Silk Road is about rebalancing streams of globalization, of course, he meant all Russian interests. And on the other hand, to me, I understand from your remarks and your presentations that we are now trying to understand whether China is doing this contest in order to in more political or in more economic terms, or we can analyze it both from this or that perspective. To me, a New Silk Road is about selling. It was the genesis for the first Silk Road. It was about selling. It was not about building infrastructure. It was purely about selling. And second, for the New Silk Road is still the same idea. It's not about investing. That's why this measure, this data presented by Lucas or by Professor Kuraji is to me it's confirming, it's proving that it's still about selling. If we think about building Polish railway or highway, it was still about selling services. If we think about investment in Lisbon in water pipe system, it was still about selling services. So for China, for Europe, as in for the world, it's the question how these resources and how this how this trade, global trade, will balance and who will win, yes, or who will get more. Thank you very much.
Thank you for all of three of you. Let's ask the other question, the Chinese representative. I know that you are Chinese because we were at the same conference in Budapest recently. Amazing. I am. You are. I am everywhere. Okay.
I'm a PhD student now in the University of Puch. I have a question to Dr. Rachel. Just now you have mentioned about the FBI. What is your opinion from the Europeans that the people are Chinese? And why are China dealing with collaboration with these 16 countries? These 16 countries, why are they with China's FBI? So you have very great differences to each country, such as the FBI to Central Europe, such as Poland, Hungary, Poland, and some former Yugoslavia countries. It's very less. So, what is your opinion from the European perspective about why these 16 countries dealing with Chinese differences?
Thank you very much. Still someone ready here in the first call? And for the first remarks, I will ask all of you to answer because everyone has a different opinion. Please.
Well, Dvorsky, I guess this question is to everyone. Curious, what is China's official and unofficial response to or view on the Russian meddling in the US election? And is there a difference between those two values?
About Russian meddling into the US at recent elections. Do you have any official or unofficial views? Personal. Okay. One was intended directly to Richard, so Richard will start. And also, if you have comments to the other questions, do it, and afterwards I will ask Bartosz and Professor. Okay?
Thank you. First of all, thank you very much for a very interesting interpretation. It really makes good sense what you say. I would only add that, again, I went too quickly through the data. I also had their data on trade. And even when it comes to trade, the statistics and trade statistics are much more accurate than FDI statistics. So even China's CE trade did not increase, and Chinese exports in CE increased very modestly. So the first thing, my wife says I'm extremely critical. So the first thing when I heard about the increasing trades, I would say that then there would be less boats arriving with the goods. So basically, probably as you said, it's about redirecting the globalization channels. That might be the case, because the data don't really show any major increases in trade. Yeah, but then the question would be whether there is a space for growth, because China is the second largest importer in the Czech Republic, for example, if I'm not mistaken. So is there really such a big space for growth? Second largest importer in the Czech Republic is China. So I think that's already quite a big position. It can grow a little bit, but then there will be a roof very, very, very soon. So I mean, let's see. And then the question, obviously, from our perspective is this something which is interesting for us? Is this in our national interest to have more and more trains coming one direction and then returning empty? Obviously, you'll probably work with this. And I'd like to ask the Chinese colleague to specify the question. So you were asking about Chinese FDI in the CE countries and about the differences. Can you please can you please tell me a little bit more what you mean?
I mean that for 16 countries, FDI, the Chinese FDI still have a great difference or a great gap, such as some Central Europe countries like Hungary, like Republic of Poland, they have much FDI, such as some former Yugoslavia countries and Baltic states.
Why is there a difference between us in the region within this 16 plus one?
Yes.
Okay, at present, there is really, in total, not much Chinese investment. So we would say, and that's what statistics show us, that Hungary has the most of Chinese investment. more than half of it was made by one single deal.
Exactly, one project.
And then that deal was actually done before 16 plus 1 was even established.
Exactly.
Now, this year there was discussion that the US steel in Slovakia might have been acquired by a Chinese company. If that happened, Slovakia would become the host of the most Chinese FDI. At this point, it's really anecdotal. One single deal can totally change the whole picture. So that's part of the answer. But actually, when you mentioned Poland, Czech Republic, Romania, as I showed in the data, and Heritage Foundation showed it well, there is unproportionately too much Chinese investment, I would even say, in the non-EU member countries. My personal explanation is similar to what I told you, that China is comfortable, it knows how to make business in those countries, it doesn't know yet how to make business in the B4 countries. Because China knows how to come to Germany and buy the best technology companies. It knows how to come to Africa and build infrastructure and work in development role. But we, before, we are somewhere in between. We don't have world-class technology, luxurious brands, but we are EU members and our infrastructure is not at African level either. So that's why, and I think one of the previous speakers mentioned it, that Chinese leaders, it's quite difficult for them to interpret what exactly make us interested.
Okay. So, I don't think I can add about FDI. And just from my perspective, I like to check that in the countries of the C region are not technologically advanced in general. And because China is seeking mostly for know-how, the high tech in Europe, that's why there is no much space for investments. The case of Polish, I mean, the terminal approach. Logistic terminal is a mystery. Minister for Defense blocked it suddenly in last December. I guess there must be something behind that. It's not only about economics, it might be some geopolitical factors. That's what I guess.
Okay, so one. Two points. First one about FDI. Let me say one example. China and US trade volume is almost 10 times than China Russian trade volume. But the interesting thing is that the structure of this trade are very diverse. China Russian trade mostly come from the federal government's deal. But China US trade, on the other hand, majority of agreements, majority volume come from private sectors. So this is very interesting to compare these two bilateral trade relations. I have no idea that number about China and Central European countries, but I think if we can do some survey, it will be very interesting. One by one experiment is in person. Another one is about the Russians' potential or kind of their intervention to US election. I must say, in China, again, say different stories, different attitudes. Government or military's attitudes is say nothing, no words about it. We don't express. But I guess majority Chinese intellectuals, liberals, fail is like to do so. Myself.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Before I wrap it up, I took the program and I discovered that at 6:30 we have the other event, which is a Georgian evening. So finally, I will ask if someone is absolutely eager to ask the question to anyone of our panelists. If not, I would like to ask for the applause for our pre-panelists. Thank you very much. Thank you all of you for this great debate. At least we are beyond the horizon. Not only Ukraine, not only Belarus, not only even Russia, up to Vladivostok, But we went farther, and this is important, and let's keep this good custom into the future our conferences. Thank you very much, and have a nice Georgian evening tonight.